school district administrator at the school district of Neillsville. This is my 20th year serving the school district of Neillsville. And I'm also the chair of the Association for Equity and Funding, and that's what brings us here today. I want to thank everyone for coming because I think this is going to be very meaningful for all of you. I am honored to be, we are honored to be in the Capitol to talk about something that's very important to all of us. I'm always humbled when I come into the Capitol and I look up at the dome and I see the words legislation, government, justice, and liberty, and I think to myself what a huge responsibility I have for the future of kids and grandkids in my position, and what all adults that come into this building have. A little bit of background on the Association for Equity and Funding. We are entering our 25th year of existence, and we are advocates for equal educational opportunity for all children, regardless of their zip code, and for fair treatment of all taxpayers, regardless of where they live in the state. Some of you may remember the Vincent Voigt lawsuit that took place in 1999-2000. The Association for Equity and Funding was the plaintiff in that case. And it was about equitable funding and a lot of good things, even though it was a 5-4 decision against us. Many good things came out of that, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. The Association for Equity and Funding has now commissioned 2 longitudinal studies since that time. The first was the segregation of opportunity in educational funding, where we looked at the Supreme Court decision in Vincent Voigt that highlighted English language learners, special education students, and economically disadvantaged. And the Supreme Court at that time said, these groups of people must be taken in consideration to be considered equitable. The first study that we did measured the disparity since that decision for about the next 12 years. And we found that the disparity was getting worse instead of better. Today's study, entitled Wisconsin School Funding and Student Outcomes, asks the question, or poses the question, does the disparity now between school districts provide or impact student achievement in any way? I will now introduce the author of that study, Scott Witkoff, to present the study. Thanks.
So thanks to John Geyer for the introduction, and to everybody in the Association for Equity and Funding for having the foresight and enthusiasm to dig deeper into what for many people is a very complex issue, and that is the funding of our public schools. So I'll be giving a brief introduction to the study, telling you a little bit about what it looked at. I'm going to highlight some significant results that you'll be able to see on the big screen here, and then just conclude with a few discussion points before we go to questions. So as John mentioned, after the first school funding study released in 2014, it became very clear to us that the funding system in Wisconsin is no longer fulfilling its mission to provide equal educational opportunity to every child, regardless of district, need, or demographic, as the Vincent v. Voigt Supreme Court decision defined. In fact, in the first study, we concluded that the school funding system is actually contributing to a new type of segregation, and that is of income inequality. But what remained unclear, and it was the big question in our mind after the results of the first study, was, does this funding disparity have any impact on student outcome? So that's what this study sought to answer. So just a quick overview of how we designed the study. So you heard John mention this idea of funding disparity. And it's really hard to quantify funding disparity when you have school districts in all different regions of the state, urban, rural, suburban, different levels of poverty, different student demographics, different tax rates, different tax levy limits. How do you define funding disparity between all those different districts? Well, what we did was, through our research, we generated what we called a funding disparity rank. And you'll see that referenced by the initials FDR, funding disparity rank. And how we came across that funding disparity rank, how we generated it, was we actually combined school funding and spending capacities for every school district in the state. Then over the 10 years of the study, we adjusted for inflation, And then we used a formula based on the work by Dr. Howard Fleeter. He's at the University of California, Berkeley, and he's advised, for example, the Ohio Department of Education on creating a formula that accounts for these high-need students as Vincent V. Voigt defined, English language learners, special needs, and free reduced lunch, or student poverty. So what we were able to do with our formula was we were able to equalize for all these factors across all the school districts in Wisconsin to actually give us an apples-to-apples comparison of schools' funding capacity based on the high-need students defined by Vincent versus Voigt. So what we did was we have a ranking from 1, which is very low disparity, all the way up through 409 for the greatest disparity. And what the index measures is the distance between each school and the funding disparity in order to meet the needs of these high-need students. So in essence, it is a ranking of schools that measures disparity between very different types of school districts on an equal grounding. So then what we had to do, once we had that, is we had to determine whether that statistical ranking has any effect on student outcome. And there are so many different measures of student outcome, which ones do you use? Well, we decided to use 2 years of DPI-issued school district report card scores, because the report card scores give us a multi-year look at a large number of factors. Secondly, we used fourth grade reading scores and eighth grade mathematics scores based on WSAS criteria, because those are well known in research literature to be significant benchmark scores for predicting future success. So to give you an idea of how big the data set was, in all, we had over 3,600 longitudinal time points. And then with all the variables, we had close to 40,000 points of data. So this is a very robust study. So we'll get on to the results here. So first, we're going to look at the actual findings about funding disparity. What were the impacts of funding disparity on student outcome? And the first thing we're going to look at is the report card scores. And the figure here, what we're looking at, very simply stated, is that as funding disparity increases, which is going from your left to right, report card scores went down significantly. As you can see, each line slopes downward from left to right. Here's what was fascinating about this outcome, is when you look at the effect of student poverty, as student poverty increases, that effect gets worse. So in essence, what we found was that the highest poverty school districts experienced the greatest negative impact of funding disparity on student outcome, while more affluent districts are less affected. It's important to note that these results affect every school district in the state, because even in more affluent districts, you see a negative effect. Secondly, this figure is a clear demonstration that funding disparity has a negative impact on student outcome. The red highlighted trend line you see here is showing us that as funding disparity rank from 1 to over 400 increases, so disparity gets worse, eighth grade math scores drop. This is significant because this is looking at specifically funding disparity effect on eighth grade math scores. And to underscore how important this outcome is, or this figure is, as many of you know, the last year of data we did was 2014. At that time, the proficiency cut score for eighth grade math was 558. So below 558 was non-proficient, 558 and above was proficient. If you note here, the lowest funding disparity districts are right at 560. So once we get below 558 and then down further ending at 550. It means that for all those school districts that fall with funding disparity great enough to decrease eighth grade math scores, it's the difference between eighth grade math proficiency and non-proficiency. That's a very significant outcome when you look at what funding disparity means to school districts all over the state. So next, not related to funding disparity, but since we had to study other factors, because there are other factors we know that impact student outcomes, such as student poverty, truancy, type of school district, we had some surprises when we did the analysis. And since student poverty has such a negative impact on district-wide student outcome, we thought it was appropriate to highlight additional, very novel results from our study that relate to student poverty. So this figure illustrates the negative effect of student poverty as it increases on report card scores by type of district. So you note that between rural, which is the blue line, urban, which is the red line, and suburban school districts, which are the brown line, each one sees a different negative impact from poverty. But what's stunning about this figure is you'll note that suburban districts experience the negative effects of higher poverty at a greater rate than both urban and rural districts. This was a huge surprise to us. And in fact, what confirmed that was the data on fourth grade reading scores. You see the same thing with suburban districts experiencing a far greater negative effect of fourth grade reading scores from poverty. And this is a critical new finding, because what it indicates is that even suburban districts that we tend to think are historically more affluent perhaps experience even worse negative effects of poverty on reading proficiency than rural and urban districts. It'd be an interesting study to find out why that's the case. So to conclude, we expect this study will serve to prompt a more honest and open discussion regarding the issues raised by our analysis of 10 years worth of longitudinal data. And I would encourage you to go to the website www.waef.net, where the full study will be available. And if anybody wants the full data set to look at, I can send it to you. So through our research, it's clear that in addition to student poverty, we may now say that the actual school funding system, which has created funding disparity in the majority of school districts for over a decade, is further contributing to systemic education problems. The data showing that suburban school districts see a greater negative effect from student poverty is critical to our understanding that these disparities impact statewide districts. So to use an analogy, to bring it down to earth, what this study has really shown is that kids, if those kids were school districts, haven't been getting enough food for 10 years, and they're not performing well. And any proposals that would consider taking away food or continuing to restrict food from those kids until they perform better would have predictable results, as we see here, a continued downward spiral. So in order to address the issues we raise in the study, it's really time to examine our moral priorities. Do we want a system where a student receives a great educational opportunity because she or he lives in an affluent area? Or do we want those opportunities for every child? Do we want communities with two different school systems, one for the affluent and one for everyone else? Or do we want every child to have great opportunities in their community school? So to conclude, I would say it's our moral imperative at this point, based on the data, to take responsibility to ensure that all children are empowered through education, no matter where they live, no matter what their circumstances, just as we would want for our own children. So thank you.
So I'm State Representative Melissa Sargent, and I'm one of those kids. I was a kid that was raised because of food stamps and because of charity in our communities. And I know that there are a lot of kids out there just like me. And there's more now than there were when I was growing up. And that's really unfortunate, because what it is that we hope and dream for our future is that we can learn from what it is that we know, facts very much like those that have been shared with us today, to help us be a more civilized and just society, so that we can be more prosperous, so that we can hope that our children will have better than what it is that we had. And I am a proud mom. A lot of how I define myself is by my motherhood to four amazing sons who have gone through the public school pipeline. And I know that when we have strong public schools, when we have a strong educational system at all levels, that we will have true economic prosperity, that we will have true justice and true morality today and into tomorrow. And I know that children and the education that they receive should not depend on the luck of the dice of the draw to what family that they were born into or to the zip code with which their family calls home. I know that our children's future should not depend on their race or their class. But unfortunately, that is what is happening today in Wisconsin. Our state's constitution, the basis of what it is that those of us that are policymakers, true public servants, abide by when we take the oath of office, requires that each and every child in our state should receive a free and equitable public education. And it is very clear that that is not happening in the state of Wisconsin right now. Due to our current funding formula, something that we have known has been broken for quite some time, I am not the first person to stand up here and say that is the case. We know that this is not happening for our children. This study is proof that what Governor Walker and his colleagues are doing to the state of Wisconsin is continuing to move us backwards. And I know that many people have a hard time realizing that facts are facts and science is science. I work with people who will argue that we don't need to pay attention to that. But this is a black or white situation. This isn't something that we need to be bickering about. Our kids are not doing well today. And the policies that are being made in this building are having a direct impact on that inequality. And that is a moral problem for our communities. Over the past three budgets, my Republican colleagues have cut $1.3 billion, with a B, billion dollars from public schools in the state of Wisconsin. And as we know, the work that's been done by the Wisconsin Association for Equity and Funding, this report, we know that these cuts are affecting different parts of our state and different children in different ways. And we must take that very seriously as policymakers. We need to find a better way. We are at a crisis point in our state. Our children are our future. There is going to be a day that we will not be here to make these decisions and to say these things. And if we do not raise up our future leaders with cognitive abilities, without the dreams that we plant in them, and the power that we provide them to be curious and innovative thinkers through our public schools, our state is going to go down the drain. And we need to stop that. I know that my colleague, Representative Pope, and our great superintendent, Tony Evers, have been long champions for the creation of better ways to do things for our schools and for our children. And I stand here today hoping that there are many of my colleagues in this building that will wake up and realize that now we can't ignore the facts. We must save our children. We must save our schools in order to save our state. I am proud of the work that I have done. I am proud of the fact that I am a product of our public schools. And I am proud of the fact that I am raising children who who are going through our state's public schools as well. But there will be a day, and maybe today is that day, where there are parents that are not proud to say that. And there are children that will not be proud to say that they are graduates of our schools. And that terrifies me. It sends chills down my spine. We need to act now. The way we are treating education in the state of Wisconsin is broken. And I know that there are extraordinary people in this building who solve extraordinary problems. But we need to remember that the reason we are here is for the ordinary people on our streets, the ordinary people that roll up their sleeves and make our state great. Because there are kids out there just like me who are eating free and reduced lunch and wearing clothes because of the charity of their communities. And we want to give them the same ability to someday be a lawmaker in this building that I have. So I appreciate all of you for your passion and for your knowledge and knowing that we need to continue to fight for these kids because these kids are our future. Thank you.
I would like to now call on Tim Sievertson. Tim is a longtime board member at the Elk Mound School District, and he has some comments about the study.
Thank you, John. When I looked at this study, it's alarming to me. Part of the reason it's alarming to me is the Vincent and Vincent Boyd was my superintendent, Bill Vincent. We've looked at this issue since that time all the way through the Supreme Court. And we knew that the language that came out of that was language that was supposed to affect how our kids learn and the equity of that and better outcomes. I have served on my local district, the state school board, the national school board, just finishing my term there in April, and have advocated for kids all the way through for them to have successful opportunities and good outcomes. We need every board member in the state to look at these, to look at them objectively without having a partisan slant or an ideology, to look at what this shows. For us to be able to look at and realize that we're all in this together, that we can't have kids whose parents move from one place to the other in the state and have a different zip code not get what they need. So with this, I am just proud to now be on part of the steering committee for the equity and funding, and for Scott and the research everybody has come through. And I just ask that everyone who hears this work together with someone to try and find the solution, because there is a better solution for this without parting out winners and losers. Our kids have to win. Education has to win. And as a board member and having my constitutional responsibilities, I owe it to the people I serve in my district through the local governance to be responsible that my students have as good as an outcome and a chance as those that have the higher spending in different areas of the state. It's a very complex problem. It's taken me since 92 to try and figure out all these pieces as they come together. So ask who you need to ask to get the information and try and work with the different organizations. And for board members, continue your board development. Work with those who can help you learn this information as you work with a team, with your superintendents, and with the kids in mind, that we're looking for successful opportunities for these students. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tim. The Association for Equity and Funding members always had a feeling that the funding system wasn't working for all of our K-12 kids. But we can't base everything on feelings. As Representative Sargent said, we now have evidence. There is evidence that this isn't working for kids. One thing I think that we need to understand is that many people are waiting for a district to go financially bankrupt before they will say that we have a problem. Folks, there is a significant difference between financial bankruptcy and educational bankruptcy. Educational bankruptcy occurs when a school district can no longer provide a high-quality 21st century education to all of its students. Just recently, out of Connecticut, there was a decision that the Connecticut funding formula was not constitutional. We've gone down that lawsuit road to try to repair the funding system in Wisconsin. Tony Evers now says that we are developing haves and have-nots in school districts across the state. If we are creating have and have-not school districts across the state, we are causing have and have-not children across the states. And that is the moral issue that we're talking about when we talk about funding. Be clear, and I want to thank Representative Sargent and Senator Vinehout for allowing us to use this venue to have the press conference. But be clear that this is not an issue of partisanship. This is an issue of morality, and this is an issue of the American dream for the next generation and the generation after that. Scott referred to the website where you can find this report. Also, you can follow us on Twitter at Equity in Funding. I encourage you to ask any questions that you might have in the future. Our contact information is on there. It is important now that we get this right for kids. That's our responsibility, and we'll all keep working toward that. My hope is that we never have to go through a lawsuit again to talk about the funding formula in Wisconsin. My hope is that people look at the evidence and say, you know what? We got to get together as adults and fix this thing. That's our hope from the association's perspective, and I hope that's your hope as well. Thank you for coming, and we appreciate so much your attendance.
Are there any questions from anybody? Wow. Okay. Oh.
Yep. They're all statisticians.
Right. All right. Thank you very much. Oh, sorry.
I hesitate to ask this, but it seems that what the study identifies is that there's not just an equity problem, there's an adequacy problem. Not only is the distribution of funds, resources available to schools inequitable, but those test results seem to indicate that it's not adequate either. How do we achieve both of those goals?
That's a great question, because in essence, we don't really know what's adequate. So for example, if you say, what's adequate to achieve educational opportunity for every child in Milwaukee, may be different from what's necessary in Wautoma, right? There's, because demographics require different needs. And, you know, when I was looking at the data and, you know, where do you start in terms of funding, we accepted what DPI has as per pupil funding as that's what's needed for the purposes of analysis. But when you really look at it, as you're saying, it's really an arbitrary number at this point. I mean, from the time that that number was set to today, things have changed significantly in terms of not only economics, but demographics and technology and educational aspirations, that it's hard to say what is adequate. But we could see a day where we run, for example, the funding disparity formula again, and you could have, instead of having a huge gap between districts, that that gap could narrow. And we could see less of a disparity between different types of districts. And I think that should be our goal. Instead of saying, you know, what is a bottom line benchmark number for every child, would be to say, let's develop a formula that accounts for these things that we need to, and inflation, and we run an analysis that shows that that disparity, instead of being, again, statistically this big, that it becomes this big. And instead of having schools ranked from 1 to 409, you have 409 or whatever it is school districts that are all tied for first, second, and third.
I think to piggyback on that just a little bit, with Tim Sievertson, who spoke earlier, I think he would agree that that's where we have to have some local wiggle room to identify what those needs are. We can't try to come up with a single number, I don't think, for every district to say that is the adequacy number, regardless of whether you live in Neenah or Neillsville. We have to have some local wiggle room, I think, in that, to find out what that adequacy is. And so I think that becomes very important as a local governance piece.
Governor Jeff, some portions of a funding system are complicated and some are relatively simple. You talked about the Vincent First Void decision and specifically students with disabilities. Can you talk a little bit about what's happened to reimbursement rates since the Vincent First Void decision in the state of Wisconsin and what that means?
You can go ahead.
Oh, well, it's basically is, if you look at the first study and we, it's actually, you know, graphed in the first study, for the majority of districts, it's actually either declined or not kept up with inflation. So in fact, in most of this, the districts that we saw, I think if I could recall, Waukesha was one of those districts where students with disabilities have really increased at a significant rate. Funding actually dropped. So in essence, funding for special needs and English language learners, I would say most districts will have seen either a decline or something that has not kept up with inflation. So it's actually been a really bad situation.
And that's what we're seeing as well. And I think what's important to understand is special ed of 10 and 15 and 20 years ago is not special education of today. We're seeing much more mental illness. We're seeing much more severe needs in special needs kids. So our funding, even if it had stayed the same, isn't meeting the needs. There was a report not long ago that came out in the state that talked about your ability to find counseling for mental illness is based entirely on where you live. And you get to certain parts of the state and there is no support for that. So the only support for kids are their local schools. And when we don't have the funding to do the things that we need to do, again, we're leaving those kids behind.
I just, to kind of piggyback on the idea of special needs and things like that, and because then we're talking about health issues. What's interesting about this figure with the drastic decline of suburban districts and the effects of poverty, the person who did the data for this is in the health research field and noted that that is actually consistent with health outcome in affluent areas. So that the effects of individual people who live in poverty in more affluent areas see far greater negative effect on health outcome than, for example, in rural and urban areas. So it's an interesting kind of parallel, but when you talk about what John alluded to with increased mental health needs and things like that for special needs students and the lack of ability for that funding to keep up with the need, much less inflation, that could speak volumes to that type of data. So, good question, thanks. Anything else? Don't be shy. Okay, well, thanks everybody for your time. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.